adjusts four ways to clean from low nap to deep.
I can say right. We will talk.
Cleans right up to walls. Big dust bag so you stop less, plus tools to clean from top to bottom, all for just $59.95.
Eureka vacuums are available at Roner's in Perry.
I'm Betty Lou Varnum, and welcome to Dimension 5. Our subject tonight is the first international conference on iceberg utilization that is being held this week on the Iowa State University campus. It is being attended by some 200 people from throughout the world, 18 countries of the world, as a matter of fact. We have a distinguished panel, and we think that you may have questions for them. If you do, these are the numbers for you to remember. 294-7307, and we will accept station-to-station collect calls. If you're calling from Des Moines, the number is 244-3738. And these are the members of our panel. We are most honored and pleased to have His Royal Highness Prince Mohammed Al Faisal. Prince Faisal is the son of the late King Faisal. The King of Saudi Arabia and the Crown Prince are his uncles. Prince Faisal is president of Iceberg Transport International Limited and the principal sponsor of the conference. He also served as a member of the conference steering committee. Thank you very much for being with us. I'm going to ask the rest of our guests to introduce themselves and to tell us what their positions are and why they are interested in the conference. Mr. Ed Cronick is a master's candidate at Harvard in economics, and you filmed the securing and transporting of our small iceberg. Is that true?
I covered it from A to Z.
A to Z. And we are going to see the A to Z coverage later on this evening. Dr. Henri Bader is a guest who was one of the keynote speakers. What is your position?
I am a consultant. I used to be a chief scientist of the Snow, Ice, and Permafrost Research Establishment of the Corps of Engineers of the U.S. Army.
Thank you, and we're delighted that you're here. To my left is Dr. Daniel Zaffarano, who has been a guest many times on Dimension 5, and always we welcome him back. Dr. Zaffarano, your title?
My title is Vice President for Research and Graduate Dean at Iowa State University.
And you also served as the conference general chairman.
Yes.
Dr. Richard Cameron is our guest. Dr. Cameron has some marvelous pictures of icebergs that we'll be seeing later. Would you tell us what your position is?
I'm the program manager for glaciology at the Division of Polar Programs at the National Science Foundation in Washington.
Thank you very much. I think that we must begin by asking Prince Faisal, has the conference lived up to your hopes and your expectations when you planned it?
Well, I think when we planned it, we weren't counting on the very successful turnout that has happened so far, and the rather more than expected distinguished attendance. And I think that the conference has lived up to more than the expectations. And I think that the results are going to reflect that.
Prince Faisal, why the conference now and why here?
Well, the conference now, I think, is because there is a need for such a new venture into a future development of a world resource that has not been developed. As to why here, I really can't answer that question, but after I've come here, I think I can answer it very well in saying that we have found a very warm welcome, and we have found a response that is beyond what we had expected. So I think, looking back at it, we have made the right choice.
And certainly there has been tremendous interest in the conference, in the iceberg that was brought as part of the conference. We've made world press, really, with it, and from the people on the street and the children in the schools to the people attending the conference, it has been most interesting and most fascinating. Dr. Cameron, what do you consider to be some of the most important questions that have been discussed?
Well, I think the matter of the physical characteristics of an iceberg as to its structure and whether or not it can maintain its physical integrity while being towed, I think that's one of the major problems. In addition to this is the other factors that are that will be acting upon the ice in transit, such as the melting due to the sea and the towing of the iceberg through the water. That's a major problem. And in addition to that, there was a question as to whether or not the Coriolis force would have an effect on the while the ice was being moved. And
what
so
is
I
the
think
Coriolis force?
Oh, this is the action of the I think Dr. Bader can do a better job with Coriolis force than I can.
Dr. Bader, what
so
is
I'm
the
gonna give it to him.
Coriolis force?
When a body is moving on the Earth's surface, it is affected by the rotation of the Earth, such as, for instance, if you were to pull it this way, it might go this way, or it might go this way. In other words, it is a deviation from the normal course which it would take if the Earth were not rotating.
And so this is one of the considerations and one of the problems that has been raised.
May I make a statement about that?
Dr. Zaffarano.
I can't refrain because it's physics.
Please don't.
If you would stand on a merry-go-round and walk in toward the center of the merry-go-round while it is rotating, you will feel yourself being pushed to one side. And that's called the Coriolis force, which does that. It has to do with the speed of rotation of the merry-go-round and the velocity with which you walk in. Now, on the Earth's surface, the Earth is rotating as a merry-go-round, and the ship is going toward the center because it's going up toward the North Pole. And so it's the speed at which the ship is going toward the center multiplied in a certain way times the speed of angular rotation.
Thank you. I've heard the term used 50 times in the last 3 days, and I never had it explained before because everyone else there knew what it meant. What do you consider some of the interesting questions that have been raised, Dr. Cronick?
By far, it's just one, the feasibility of the idea. Being the first conference, that everybody is coming together with a lot of premonitions about icebergs. Basically, it's the fact that you've got scientists from around the world chewing these ideas that have so far been more mythical than actual scientific data on paper. And for the first time, the people have it on paper, and this is what comes out of here will be probably the best decision of the direction to take from now. It's a world meeting of immense stature. And so the direction we go from now is what the conference will actually decide.
Do any of you feel that any of the questions that have been raised carry with them the negation of the idea? Is there something so far that makes the concept impossible? Or the actuation of the concept?
Who would like to answer this question?
Why don't you all answer? Prince Faisal?
No, but I think, as you know, I am an exponent of the idea. So I have a positive view of it, but I think that the conference has demonstrated that an idea of such nature could be discussed in a way that is positive. I don't think that anybody in the conference would really want to prove that it doesn't work, but there are certain questions, there are certain uncertainties that have to be resolved. And this is one of the positive results of this conference. It's not always good to have an idea and then just run off in the wild yonder and do it and then find out it doesn't work. But I think everybody is pulling to make it work, but before we can say it works, we have to resolve many questions. I think that point should be stressed.
Your enthusiasm has not been dampened at all.
Well, I'm with the idea until everybody, like Dr. Bader and Dr. Cameron, would tell me it can't work.
What do you really hope to accomplish if it does work? Let's suppose that the icebergs can be found and can be transported and now are in sight.
Well, I think the objective is not really to transport the iceberg. The objective is to bring the iceberg to provide a certain need for a certain use. So what is hoped that would be accomplished is that when the iceberg arrives at what we call the thirst belt, it would be a source of water for these areas that have historically been water short areas. They have been deserts. So I would say that iceberg transport is really a means to an end. The end is to provide water in order to develop these areas and improve the quality of life in these areas. If when you take a place like Saudi Arabia, for instance, which does not have a single lake or stream in its area, and that covers about 1,200,000 square miles. And if you bring this water to it, it's like watering these plants. I mean, if you don't water them, they will become brown, they will die. Well, Saudi Arabia is that way now. But if you bring the water, we are hoping that it will flourish and be green. So that is really the objective that we are talking about here.
Would you other gentlemen like to comment about whether or not you feel that anything so far has made the idea totally unworkable?
I would say no. There are still many problems. We don't know enough to give an answer today. And it will be some time before we have the answer of the feasibility. Can it be done? You might say, yes, it can be done. The question is, perhaps more, can it be done at an acceptable price? You could fly ice up in airplanes if the price doesn't matter. So the question is, can this ice be transported from Antarctica to where it is needed at acceptable cost?
Well, if I may interject here, I think the cost is not just in terms of money. I think we should also be careful that the cost will not be high in terms of ecology, for instance, in terms of danger to navigation, in terms of the failure of the idea itself. So the cost cannot be figured only in terms of the money involved.
There are many people, I think, who have been concerned about the dangers to the environment, to the ecology, both along the route and as a somehow depleting the supply of ice in the world. And
that's been a popular myth.
God does not want this to happen, this kind of thing. Is this a legitimate concern?
If I may say, if God didn't want it to happen, he wouldn't have put the ice cap over there. Right? But the point is that if we are going to develop this resource to the fullest extent that we are permitted by our means, I think it will not affect the ice cap in any way. It's very insignificant in relation to it, and I think everybody would not disagree with this situation.
Dr. Zaffarano?
I've learned many things at this conference. And just to give you some perspective, it was rather fascinating for me to find out that a good share of the fresh water on the surface of the Earth is tied up in glacier ice and icebergs. And I think the number is 85% or more, maybe higher.
Higher.
More than 85% of all the fresh water on the face of the earth is tied up in ice. And of that, about 90%, am I right, is at the Antarctic region. I think it was 9% in Arctic and 90% in Antarctic region, and the rest is of the ice. And the rest is in the mountain glaciers and the Rocky Mountains and the Alps. And so in the Antarctic, we have the greatest store of fresh water of any place on the surface of the earth. That's rather interesting. Another fact I remember was that whereas in Iowa we have an annual rainfall of what, 36 inches, something like that, depends on the year. In Saudi Arabia, the annual rainfall is about 1/4 inch, I think, is what you told me.
In certain areas of Saudi Arabia, I think the average overall is about 4 inches.
Oh, 4 inches?
Yes.
Oh, it is 4, I'm sorry, yes. I misunderstood. Well,
but Dr. Cameron, comment that the for the classification of deserts, it's less than 10 inches of rain per year. That's what is considered a desert, and by that definition, the Antarctic is also a desert, you see, because there's less than 10 inches of rain or water precipitation per year. It's a cold desert, so it's we're talking about moving ice from a desert to a desert.
Is it a renewable resource?
The Antarctic ice is going to be there for many, many years, millions of years, and it is a renewable resource, and we could take all the world would need to, I think, forever practically.
Even if this is an idea whose time has come and the technology is found to make it work and all that sort of thing, we're not going to endanger the ice cap.
No way.
No, we're not going to touch the ice cap.
We're only going
to take the ice that has already moved out to sea. It carves off and it floats away and then it melts. So instead of letting it melt there, we would transport it and let it melt somewhere else. We wouldn't go and chop ice off the ice cap. We would take the ice that the ice cap is sloughing off.
Which would seem to be wasted anyway. Going
yes.
off and melting and not being of use to anyone.
You know, Betty Lou, there's so many things that are not known yet about icebergs that I'm a little bit appalled. It turns out that most of the data that have been collected on the survival time, the paths of icebergs, most of these data have been collected on a secondary basis. They weren't the primary interest of the investigator. But very early in the meeting, somebody said, well, we would like to see the statistics. On the average, how long does an iceberg last before it disappears? How far does it go? What is the average size of an iceberg? And I think early in the meeting I was told that these data are not available. There has been no good statistical survey of icebergs as yet. Is that correct, Dr. Bader?
That is correct. But see, the icebergs come off by the tens of thousands. So they're in the way when you're down there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not easy to do the statistics.
May I say that I was talking to this gentleman from England.
Dr. Swithenbank?
Swithenbank tonight, at dinner tonight. And he was saying to me that there are 10 years worth of pictures taken from satellites of the Antarctic. And that what we could do is we can follow icebergs by their shape. Their shape stays relatively constant. And that if someone would get hold of these pictures and study 10 years worth of pictures, how is it, one every 18 minutes or something of that nature, quite a number of pictures.
For 10 years?
Yeah, but these data are available, but no one has ever looked. That one could start accumulating some of the statistical analysis that I think is desirable as to what is the longevity of an iceberg, what is the average size of an iceberg, how far do they go, simply by looking at these pictures carefully.
Yes.
And I'm amazed that no one has taken this yet. I'd like to suggest it for one of our master's or PhD theses.
Or several.
Or several.
Well, I think, Dr. Zaffarano, that nobody has wanted to do it.
Nobody has wanted to.
There was no need for it.
It's the purpose of this conference.
So new.
But this is what is going to be stimulated now, I think.
Yes.
After
well,
this conference.
Certainly, no one has taken a close look at the distribution of icebergs in the Antarctic. I think there are some papers on this. I think the Soviet Gordienko had done some compiling of records over the years, but the International Ice Patrol has been sort of counting icebergs and keeping track of those that come off the Greenland ice sheet, because those icebergs move down the west coast of Greenland into the shipping lanes. And so I think that there is a lot of data available on that group of icebergs.
Yeah, and also the ocean currents are fairly well known in the Northern Hemisphere, coming down from the Arctic along Newfoundland and so forth. The currents are pretty well plotted and maps are available from our Navy. But the currents, which we will depend upon to transport iceberg from the Antarctic, are not that well known. And it's rather interesting to me that you can look at the surface of the ocean with radar and you can see the swirls and you can see the cleavages and so forth. But the currents that really would affect an iceberg, which had a draft of several hundred meters, are below the surface, and these have not been well measured in the Antarctic. And so there's just a lot of work left to do before we actually get to the point of laying out a path for an iceberg.
Our viewers would like to know, why wouldn't it be feasible to desalinate seawater rather than transporting icebergs? Why would that not be a superior way of getting a freshwater supply or a usable water supply?
We have an expert in our midst.
My former employment was with the government, and I am known as Mr. Desalination, by the way. So that was my field before I left it to transfer to icebergs. I think in that action, when I've answered the question about my opinion of this, is that I think that once we prove the feasibility, really, of the icebergs, it will be definitely less costly than desalting water. But we have to prove the feasibility. And we have, when I said before that we were talking about the environment, about the ecology and all that, I meant that in the sense that we have to really be sure. Today we cannot afford to take chances with it. And this is why I'm saying it. Not that there will be a danger, but that in case there is, we should be sure.
Prince Faisal, I think it would be interesting to the viewers to hear about the magnitude of the desalination program in your country. Now, it's really surprising.
Well, I think that, and that also could demonstrate what, how this, the icebergs will be more interesting. The desalination program that we have, and here we are producing really water and electricity, you see, these are associated plants. We are going to spend, we have spent about one third of that money already, and we're going to spend it all by 1980, 81. We're going to spend $15 billion. By that time, based on 1974 prices, for desalting water from the sea and producing electricity. A project like the one we have, what costs can we say? $2 billion, $3 billion?
Oh, at most, I would say.
So the comparison is right there. You know, it's just the figure is just no comparison.
I was thinking of the amount of water you already desalinate, the millions of gallons per day. It's rather
well, desalination program that we have set up is going to produce approximately 500 million gallons per day. Now these are imperial gallons, which are a little bit larger than US gallons. Now, one iceberg can produce at the rate, and this is a relatively small one, we can go bigger than that, can produce 200 million gallons a day, just one. So there you have a another advantage. Another advantage to it is that essentially you're in desalting, you are using an unnatural process. And you are consuming fuels with the attendant potentiality for pollution. You are increasing the seawater temperature. Certainly, maybe some people would argue that it's not enough to cause any problems. I used to do that, by the way. But the people that are involved in production of, for instance, 5 million gallons per day plant, which is a small production we have in Saudi Arabia, we are employing for a 5 million gallon per day plant 160 people just to keep it running. We are consuming fuel, we're burning oil in the atmosphere, there is air pollution, sea pollution, there's some noise pollution that you might say, and just the picture for the icebergs looks so neat and clean that I really wish it we will eliminate all the difficulties so that we can get it in. And the water purity in the iceberg is more than in if you desalt it.
So in a sense you can say that in moving the iceberg along, the pollution that will come from this is like distilled water in the sea.
It is.
And we're going to be polluting the sea with clean water.
And there is another aspect. You can actually combine this with the desalting, and by cooling the surrounding seawater, you can actually improve the production of these desalting plants. So you're getting an added economic advantage there, as well as if, and this has to be tested, if some sort of effect can be generated from these icebergs on the microclimate, you might even improve the electricity problem, where you will need less electricity because in areas that are hot, you don't put air conditioning as much. And that way you can decrease your fuel consumption. I mean, you can build a case that is really fantastic for icebergs.
A number of our viewers, if I may ask this, Dr. Zaffarano, I don't think they doubt that the iceberg is going to be captured after it's been selected, and it's going to be transported, and it's going to be off the coast of Saudi Arabia. But I think some of them are having trouble with understanding how the water's going to get in. Is that the easiest problem?
Well, there are problems attendant with any problem of this sort, but I think that it is not an insurmountable problem. The essential thing is the performance of the iceberg. What is this piece of ice going to do? This is where we don't have the information. But transporting water over the sea, onshore, remember the oil business has been doing it for a long time. They have been transporting liquid all over the world, you know. But there are certain peculiarities to the performance of ice, and I think Dr. Bader here can really give an idea of what they are more than I can.
And perhaps we can do that when Dimension 5 continues after this message.
You're in Five Country, and we're WOI-TV from Ames, ABC for Central Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
Our guests tonight are participants in the first international conference on iceberg utilization being held at Iowa State University this week. The conference does end tomorrow. Dr. Zaffarano, you wanted to make a point about icebergs as a form of energy.
Well, I would like to make a statement about something I learned today. And that was that because of what I shall explain, called the latent heat of ice, then an iceberg, in some sense, is a form of, is an energy source. And one of the statements today was that the value of the energy that you could get as a result of using the iceberg in the cycle may exceed the value of the water that you get from the iceberg. Now let me explain. Whenever you have a heat engine, what you do is you operate the engine between two temperatures. Something has to be very hot, and you have to discharge heat to a cold reservoir. And you know, power plants have to discharge heat into the river. You cannot have an engine that doesn't discharge any heat. So various engines have been proposed, and one of them is a engine that works in the ocean. And this kind of engine would use the temperature difference between the top of the ocean and the bottom of the ocean, maybe 20 degrees or so, or a little less than that. And you would operate just the way you operate a refrigeration cycle using liquid ammonia. It would condense at the bottom with the cold water, and it would evaporate with the hot water. Now, the point is that the difference between the high temperature and the low temperature is a measure of the efficiency you can get out of such an engine. Now, you can see with a power plant where you burn coal that you can go up to many hundreds of degrees for the high temperature, and the low temperature would be the temperature of your river. And so you have a large difference between the high temperature and low temperature, and you get a fairly high efficiency. Typically in a power plant it's 30 or 40%, maybe 30%. Now with a heat engine which operates from the ocean, which has a very small differential in temperature, you can only get a small efficiency, just 2 or 3%. One of the things you could do is to use the iceberg. Instead of discharging to the temperature of just water, you might discharge at the temperature of ice, and that moves the low energy level down, and so you've increased the spread here, and so you can increase the efficiency of that kind of engine. And such engines are proposed to be floated in the sea, and they would simply use the liquid nitrogen, liquid ammonia cycle to run a propeller, a turbine, and generate electricity in the sea. But if you use the iceberg as part of that engine plan as a discharge for it, you're increasing the efficiency. So in effect, what you're doing is you're melting the ice in the iceberg, and you're using that as a reservoir for the waste heat, see? And so it's helping you increase the efficiency of your pump, and at the same time you're melting water.
Are you also propelling the iceberg itself? Is the energy used, is it possible to use
that?
That
was another proposal. That's a different proposal. I'm only talking about melting the iceberg in situ and running an engine from it. There are all kinds of ideas about propelling the iceberg, including one by Prince Faisal.
And someone suggested that while the iceberg is in situ, it could be used for skiers on top and
mountain climbers
and tourists, and that would all be part of it too. You were talking about how the iceberg would be moved. And your interest is in...
Well, this is the subject of a paper that I cooperated on with Dr. Shaukat, who is an engineer with us. And we're suggesting to use pedal wheels. And now this thing has to be tested, determined whether it works or not. But the interesting part of this is that we're going back in technology instead of forward.
There's an interesting point about that, Lou, and that is with a conventional tugboat that we have now, you have a propeller which is a few feet in diameter and rotating relatively rapidly. And that kind of tugboat has very low efficiency when you are moving very slowly through the water, as you would be with an iceberg. And it's very much like a... Well, you never made model airplanes, but if you made model airplanes, you knew that with a slow-moving airplane, you have a big, fat propeller that moves very slowly to pull it along. And so one of the papers had to do with the size of the propeller that you would need you really wanted to get some efficiency in the towing of an iceberg. We're talking about one knot, a speed of one knot, which is what? It's 8 1/10 of a mile per hour or something like that.
It's 1.8 miles, isn't it?
Oh, is it more than 1.7? What's one knot?
1.15 miles per hour.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. 1.155 miles per hour. Very slowly. And the iceberg would move very slowly. And in order to get an efficient tugboat, what you need is a tugboat which has a propeller which is 50 meters in diameter, 150 feet in diameter. And it should move about, 10 seconds per revolution. And of course, that's a different kind of tugboat than we have now. And the proposal that Prince Faisal co-authored would be to use a very slow-moving big propeller, only a paddle wheel in his case, you see, instead of a screw. So you need a new kind of technology to propel things very slowly through water with lots of force.
I think that at this point it might be a very good idea, and we will be asking your questions. We haven't had a look at an iceberg. Dr. Cameron has some pictures that he took, and I think that at this point, if you would just tell us about the icebergs that we're seeing. The rest of you may comment if you see one that you particularly like, and what the properties of the iceberg are.
All right, this is a photograph of part of the Antarctic Peninsula area, which is just south of South America. Mm-hmm. It's a long ridge of mountains, and there's ice and flowing down off the mountains into the sea. And so in the foreground in this photograph, we see some of the let's say smaller icebergs that are generated as this ice moves into the sea. So this is a photograph showing relatively small icebergs. This photograph shows part of the Ross Ice Shelf. It's a vast, let's say it's like a bay, large bay the size of Spain that has been, ice has flowed down into that area and out onto the water. And as the ice moves across the surface of the water, the snow accumulates on the surface, and so it builds up a very smooth plain of snow. And the thickness here at the edge of the ice shelf is probably about 200 meters, with something like maybe 30 or 40 meters of that being above sea level. And this is a photograph of an iceberg that would have calved or broken off of that ice shelf. This is a what you call a tabular iceberg, and you can see that the action of the sea has, in this photograph anyway, you can see a few caves off to the one in the middle actually there, and one off to the left.
Dr. Cameron, what is a tabular iceberg?
Oh, well, Betty Lou, I think you've been over at the meeting for some of those discussions. Where,
there was an argument.
A friendly discussion. I think the good Captain Kohlmeier from the Coast Guard indicates that there are tabular icebergs in the Arctic as well as the Antarctic, but they are we will have to discuss that further, but I think that traditionally the tabular iceberg is meant to mean an iceberg with a flat top, or like a table, that has come off of, been generated by one of the large ice shelves. We have the Ross Ice Shelf on the New Zealand side of the continent, and then on the Atlantic side, if you will, we have the Ronnie and Filchner ice shelves, large shelves that produce these tabular icebergs. Now this photograph shows one of the tabular icebergs that has been worn quite a bit by the sea. You have a nice arch there that actually looks like a flying buttress on Notre Dame in Paris. But the top of the iceberg, you can see off to the right, is a flat plane. It's tilted because this iceberg has melted around the edges and tilted slightly. One could possibly call it a tabular berg, but not really. It has a very rough surface. You can see the stratification a little bit in this iceberg. Snow falls in the Antarctic year after year, and you just get a series of layers building up so that as the material, the snow densifies and turns to ice, you get this layering.
Yes. May I point out here that when you are looking at an iceberg, you are not seeing ice, you are seeing snow. The almost everything that is above the water level, which you see, is snow, and the ice is down below. You see about, for every foot height, there are 5 feet below. When we talk about the tip of an iceberg, we're thinking about a Greenland iceberg, which is usually it's like this, and the tip is out. Well, the tabular icebergs, you haven't got a tip, but you have a large plate above. That is made of snow and not ice.
This photograph gives you the scale of the iceberg. This is a large supply ship moving along the coast of East Antarctica. As a matter of fact, the photograph was taken in January 1956. I happened to take that photograph. This was an area where we were trying to establish a base, and there were so many of these large icebergs and associated sea ice in the area that we had to try to get to the continent 3 different times. We would head south and we would just get turned back by the ice conditions.
Dr. Cameron, is there a known largest iceberg, or is there a largest iceberg on record?
Oh, I think there are icebergs that have been sighted that almost, seems to me there was one sighted almost 100 miles long one time. Mm-hmm. I think, is that right? It seems to be.
Yes, there is one now just near the South Shetland Islands, which is out of the sea ice. It's out at sea, and it has run aground there, and it has been it's been there for 3 months, and it is more than 100 kilometers long. That is about 70 miles.
Yes.
It contains 1,000 cubic kilometers of ice. This is an enormous amount of ice. And it's been sitting there for 3 months now. It is so large that it is quite easily seen on the weather satellite pictures.
But this particular iceberg, you and I were talking about this today, that we've had a lot of discussions at this meeting as to the rather terrible effects that the sea is going to have on these icebergs as they are hopefully transported someday, and that they're going to be breaking up and so forth. And you commented, I believe, that
yes,
here's an iceberg that's been up there for some time and that sea.
It should be breaking up, according to theory, and it isn't breaking up.
As a matter of fact, Dr. Swithenbank has observed this iceberg for 10 years, isn't that correct? Is this
maybe
the one?
Yes, that's the one.
For 10 years.
It's more old than
any other statement at this whole conference, the fact that this iceberg exists gives me rather experimental proof that it's possible. This iceberg is much larger than any we're thinking of towing, isn't it?
Oh, yes, of course.
Yes.
Yes. But we also, of course, have seen a lot of them, which they do break up.
Yes.
They have a trail of small icebergs behind them, and pretty soon they vanish. So there are probably different kinds. There are good icebergs,
yes,
and bad icebergs.
Yes.
And we will have to learn to distinguish them, so that we don't latch on to a bad one, which will sort of break up on us, but we latch on to the good ones, and that may not be easy.
There has been an attitude on the part of those who know icebergs firsthand, seems to me to indicate some mystique about them, if you will, in that when you speak of good icebergs and bad icebergs and the great respect that is paid to the iceberg and its activities, internal or external. How dangerous are icebergs? We know what they did to the Titanic.
Oh, yes,
if
you run into it.
But if you're towing it, what kind of problem would you expect from the iceberg itself, let alone the procedure of moving it or its melting or whatever? What are the idiosyncrasies of icebergs?
Well, if it breaks in half or 2 or 3 pieces, you will lose it. And it is worth several several million dollars, at least one iceberg, a small one. The bigger ones could be worth much, could be worth $100 million, one iceberg. So it, you spend a lot of money towing it, and then it breaks up on you. But this is not a danger, this is a lot. I mean, obviously, if an iceberg breaks up, then there are a lot of small icebergs around, and it might be a danger to ships, certainly.
I'd like to make add one more comment there. You talked about how dangerous icebergs can be. You said that if you run into one, that would be a problem. But I was in a situation at one time off the coast of the Antarctic again in about, I guess, December. Well, anyway, but in the IGY. We were setting up, I was with a group, and we were involved in the establishment of a station at Cape Hallet. And we had, I think, two cargo ships and one icebreaker with us at that time. And the sea ice was quite thick. In other words, you know, that's about maybe 4 or 5 feet thick. And we were moving through the pack, getting close to the shore, and we were about to offload some cargo and so forth, but the wind came up. And so at that time, the sea ice pressed around all of these ships. And when you have that amount of force of wind on the sea ice, it really becomes very, very tight. Okay, so the ships are locked in the sea ice because of the wind, all right? And then this iceberg, which is moving with the current, just starts coming towards the main cargo ship, you see?
Oh, wow.
And there you could run around on the deck of the ship, I suppose, but you could, you know, you could run, but you couldn't hide anywhere. And so the iceberg is just bearing down on the ships. But,
did you
survive?
Did you survive?
No, I didn't. But actually, you know, so
which
that
makes
we were
you
just
an even
lucky.
More unusual guest.
Yeah. Well, we were just lucky that, you know, the wind, the current changed a little bit. And the ships were able to move away. So
the only thing worse than running into an iceberg is having
one
run
over.
Well, let us say you are towing an iceberg and you are getting near to destination, so you want to stop. You don't want to run it on shore, so you want to stop. So you take your tug and you pull backwards, and it'll take about, for not a very big one, it would take 22 miles to stop it. You can't just stop it suddenly. It's such a big mass that when it starts moving, it just keeps on moving for a long time, even if you do nothing to it.
Well, that's like these, you know, the tankers have that problem. The large tankers, mm-hmm. once they're mm-hmm. underway, they just can't stop.
Yes, but the tanker is, what, 500,000 tons?
No, all right, but I'm saying, but it's on a different scale. But,
I was impressed with some movies we saw today of the actual towing of very, very small icebergs off the coast of Newfoundland. And these are very small ones in which they would loop a cable around it and pull them for a short time. And they had a couple crew members poised with axes over the hawser into the tow cable, that if anything went wrong, the instructions were to chop the cable.
Quickly and go. You know, you answered several questions all at once with the business of, all right, you've got it started, now how do you stop the iceberg? Or what are the problems attendant? But there are a number of questions that deal with this, and I'm sure that it's such a simple question, but I think many people do not understand about the kind of ice in an iceberg. For example, one variation of the question is, why aren't the icebergs saltwater since they come from the ocean?
Aha, uh-huh.
They don't come
from the ocean. That's
there enough.
Takes care of that one.
All right, then where do they come from?
Well, okay, you do get a little snow here in Iowa, I think, now and
yes,
then.
Yes, periodically.
More than mm-hmm. you want.
We even get icebergs.
Yes, you do.
Now, yes.
One of
these. If the snow didn't melt here during the summertime, spring and summer, and you allowed that snow dust to build up, then you would before long have an ice sheet covering this part of the country. And so this is what has happened in the Antarctic. We've had snow falling and not melting year after year. So the continent is covered by a large ice sheet. The snow has turned to ice. There's a Dr. Bader did one of the early papers on the densification of snow in Greenland, and plotted the increase in density with depth, such that knowing the temperature and the accumulation, you would be able to calculate the depth at which the snow would turn to ice, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
Yes. So the once the ice sheet is formed, ice moves down slope because of gravity, and there's internal deformation of this material. It's plastic, this ice. There's this internal deformation plus sort of sliding on the bed. And so this ice flows down to the coast, and it's all this fresh water from snow, and then floats out onto the sea as these ice shelves were pictured earlier, and breaks off, and so we have fresh water. And Iowa State University did an analysis on the ice that that Mr. Cronick brought from Alaska, and that's very clean water.
Dr. Zaffarano?
Some proof of the fact that the ice is formed from snow is the great number of bubbles in the ice. We have had our iceberg parked in front of Sheman Continuation Center all day today, and people have been coming to take small pieces off of it. I'm afraid there may not be any left of it by tomorrow. But a characteristic of the iceberg ice is it's full of tiny bubbles, about a millimeter or 2 millimeters in diameter. And I think these come as a result of the snow entrapping air and then squeezing and being converted into ice. And then these air bubbles agglomerate in the ice. And what actually happens, I believe, is that the oxygen and the nitrogen in the air diffuse out, whereas carbon dioxide is more soluble in water than, as you know, in Cokes and so forth, than air, than in nitrogen. And so these little bubbles, primarily of carbon dioxide, which are entrapped, they came from the snow originally as it came down.
Marvelous.
I'm sorry. I have to contradict you. That
good. You know much more about it than I do.
The air in the bubbles is essentially the air that was entrapped. If it contains carbon dioxide, it was in the air when it was entrapped.
Yes, I read in a publication that the amount of carbon dioxide in the entrapped bubble was 10 times the amount of carbon dioxide expected in air.
This is under very special circumstances.
Oh, I see.
Yes.
I see.
We will continue our discussion when Dimension 5 continues. That will be after this message.
You're in 5 Country, and we're WOI-TV from Ames, ABC for Central Iowa.
Our subject tonight is the first international conference on the utilization of icebergs, and we have a number of questions from our viewers, but before we get to another one, there was one additional slide that Dr. Cameron had that is a most interesting one that he thought that you would like to see, and he would like a chance to comment.
Well, near the coast of the Antarctic Peninsula, for a number of years they have noted a peculiar kind of iceberg, and this one is shown here. It's sort of a dark green, they've called it a bottle green iceberg. And one biologist that has looked at this iceberg from the ship, this ship in the foreground, you're standing on the ship here in this photograph, is the Hero. It's a small research ship owned by the National Science Foundation. And the iceberg, when this biologist looked at it, said that, well, that green color cannot come from algae. But the question is, what is it? Why is it that green? Because it obviously has rotated. I mean, it has turned over because it looks water-worn. But we did not get a sample of this green ice, and hopefully this coming year someone down there will do that. But in addition to the green icebergs in this area, Dr. Swithenbank indicates that there are such things as black icebergs, Now that would be interesting for me to see, I think. But there are included material, I'm sure.
This is like the first white man who saw a giraffe. He said, there ain't no such animal. There ain't no such animal as a green iceberg, but it's there.
It's there.
It has no business being there.
Right. Do you have any theories as to what causes the
color? Whatever.
But won't it be fun to find out if the sample is obtained?
Well, may I advance a theory?
Oh, maybe. Yes, please.
Maybe it turned over and now it's green with envy.
Prince Faisal, there are a number of our viewers who would like to know what kind of timetable you're projecting for yourself and for the endeavor.
Well, really for the endeavor here, a timetable has not been set really. We would like to get it as soon as possible because the conditions in Saudi Arabia are such that we are in an emergency water situation. But I think that a schedule of between 3 to 5 years to determine the real feasibility of this project, unless we have a break, you know, or something, might not be too far out. I don't know. Dr. Bader,
yes, perhaps 3 to 5 years. To say yes, it can be done, and then you have to start making tests, let's say another 2 or 3 years. And then you need tugboats, big ones, which we haven't got, about 5 to 10 times as powerful as the biggest tugboats we have now. And then you need certain installations at the receiving end. So if I may hazard a guess, the first iceberg would be delivered not before 10 years from now. This might be a reasonable estimate. It might be possible to do it faster, but the price would go right up if you do it too fast. If it's a crash program, is always very expensive. But on the research that we have to do, that is, we have to answer certain questions by observations in the field. This cannot be hurried. We can go down at certain times of the year. There have to be preparations. So, Your Highness, your estimate of 3 to 5 years is, I think, a fairly good one.
Have you been to the Antarctic?
I am ashamed to say no.
Saddened.
But I hope to be there soon.
That was
it's
another thing.
It's too cold for me.
Our viewers wanted to know whether you were going to plan on going so that you
yes,
could.
Yes, definitely.
Well, maybe you'll get to see the green iceberg.
Maybe I could comment. I think it would be anyone interested, like the prince, too interested in this kind of project. I think that if there is a way, I think you should get there.
You might invite me too, because I've never been to Antarctica either. I have sent dozens of people down, but I've never been myself.
Well, I leave next month for about a month, so.
Well, your schedule is too soon for
too us. Too soon? All right. Well, we can make it there.
We have, 10 years to go there?
10 years. Well, you don't have to leave next week, then. Okay.
Our viewers would like to know whether the mass transport of large icebergs, once it has started, what do you foresee will be the effect on local and world climate?
This is a very interesting question. We don't know, really.
I'd like to make a reasonable estimate. Local climate, very local, some effect. World climate, none whatever. Absolutely none whatever.
So that where the iceberg finally is moored, there would be some effect. You would not expect major change along the path of the iceberg's passage?
No.
Well, may I interject here and say we are talking about icebergs and we are talking about their being very large, but compare them to the area of the Indian Ocean, for instance. They're nothing, you know, and compared to the Earth, you're talking about a very insignificant thing. I mean, so people, there have been questions about the tilt of the axis of the Earth and all that, and that's just ridiculous, really.
Well,
Maybe we should.
Dr. Cameron and then Dr. Bader.
I was just going to comment that when I came to Ames on last Sunday, it was quite nice and warm. And I think the iceberg came that same day, and it was awfully cold tonight. I don't know if they're related.
We might say the size of the icebergs we might expect to hold. The smallest, let us say, might be about 50 million tons. That it probably would not. The smaller the iceberg, the more it'll cost per cubic meter of ice, per gallon of water, if you like. Now, the smallest might be 50 to 100 million tons. The largest might be perhaps 1 billion tons. This is the range that.
That's the tonnage range. Could you give us an idea of what the dimensions would be in terms of length and width and height?
Well, the thickness would be about 250 meters. So the smallest iceberg would be about, you see, if it's 250 meters thick, it has to be wider so it doesn't turn over. So it might be about 500 meters wide. And
what's a kilometer, or 1,000 meters long?
Something, 1,000 to 2,000.
1,000 meters.
1,000 to 1,000.
Approximately
1,500
meters long, which is about 5,000 feet long and about 1,500 feet wide.
There was a learned paper at the session that the width of the iceberg should be 1.5 times the depth of the iceberg for stability.
Yes, sort of a minimum, yes.
How does one find the ideally shaped iceberg? Does one find, is it made or well, or it, is it is it, it born?
Well, it, no, we don't make them. We pick them up as they are. So it would be a somewhat elongated shape, and it would be, they are often more or less rectangular, but only more or less.
So it would be a question of studying various icebergs in a given locale and saying,
in other words, eeny, meeny, miny, moe.
Yeah. And the good iceberg
would be
is the one that would be of the approximate dimensions that you've mentioned,
yes, and then you
without
have to,
bad fissures and
when
and
you found
crevasses.
That, you still have to determine whether it is a good iceberg or a bad one. That means, is it a strong one or a weak one?
It's going to be fun to see you going about that and picking that first iceberg. What a treat.
It's
the very first one, how important that one will be.
It would be an interesting sight.
Dr. Bader, is it true the story is that there are about 10,000 icebergs a year produced from the Ross Ice Shelf?
I really don't know. Well, it depends on what
sea
size,
so
you see.
Yes.
If you take something like, let's say, 1,000 feet as the minimum you want to count, there are probably more, you see. If you take 3,000 feet, there might be less. So it's always a question of the size you're looking at.
What I'm getting at is that there probably are many icebergs of approximately the right size available at any particular time. It's a question of picking the right one.
Yes, a larger number than we're ever likely to use.
Well, the front of the Ross Ice Shelf is several hundred miles long, and it moves forward, at least the forward motion of this this ice front is something in the order of 3,000 feet. Yeah, 3,000 feet a year, but the apparent position of the ice front does not change. Therefore, you're discharging along that whole several hundred mile area. And that whole line is being discharging icebergs all the time.
The point is,
although it doesn't, you know, it doesn't. It is not a regular affair. Sometimes that ice will move forward maybe for a couple of years and then you'll get a break off.
At any rate, it shouldn't be too difficult to find several icebergs which might qualify at any one time.
No, it should not be difficult, especially with the satellite, the Landsat pictures, which is taken by the satellites, will already show you where to go to find them.
But I think later on, after studies are made of where the appropriate sized icebergs seem to be coming from, and then after you do a lot of studies on the physical integrity of these particular icebergs, I'm sure that there'll come a day that you'll know where to pick up.
Why do you say physical integrity instead of strength?
Well, it's because
he likes to obfuscate.
Oh, yes. Well, I've been in Washington too long. That's a problem. That's very simple.
And it may be a good thing that you're going to the Antarctic in the next month.
Yes, thank you.
It needs to be recharged.
A number of our viewers are interested in why you have written off the Arctic. We mentioned this slightly, but why?
Oh, that's easy. The Arctic icebergs are very small. And where are you going to use them? You come down, on one side you've got the east coast of North America, which has plenty of water. On the other side you've got Russia and Europe. They have plenty of water.
Would this be a source for California?
Oh, no. They're too small. See, something like 200 meters... A 200-meter iceberg in the Arctic is a big one.
So that there aren't very many, if any, tabular icebergs in the Arctic.
Yes, that's right.
At any rate, but that's why you haven't been.
There's plenty of ice there. Mm-hmm.
Yes, although also remember that the Antarctic has about 90% of the water available, so that you have a larger reservoir.
It's a supermarket of icebergs.
Yes.
A number of our viewers would like to know who owns it. Who owns the ice at the Antarctic?
Shall I stick my neck out? Well, according to what we know up to now, nobody owns it.
Nobody owns the iceberg.
Nobody owns the icebergs. And I don't think anybody owns the ice.
There is a treaty at the moment of
exploitation, but right. No ownership.
That's right.
Yes. So. That's a fine point.
I mean,
you know, I think that the iceberg itself is really a derelict.
Ship at sea.
You see, and whoever captures it owns it.
First come, first serve.
You see, but I think that eventually some sort of international regulation should be made to this, because we're not talking here about just icebergs. There is a lot of other resources in the area, which, for one thing, oil, I mean, is being talked about now, and all kinds of things.
I'd like to get back to the treaty for a moment. You say that no one owns it. I think that there are a number of nations that have laid claim to various parts of the Antarctic continent, and I think those claims are approved in their respective governments and so forth.
That's irrelevant, because you're going to pick them up more than 200 miles offshore.
The iceberg's fine. They're free. Anybody wants one, just go get one and take it home. But I'm talking, you know, I think I gave a wrong impression when we talked about the continent itself. I just wanted, in that the treaty is being discussed in London, I think it's rather important that... you know, maybe people would like to know about that. There are about 12 nations that signed the original Antarctic Treaty in 1959 to say that, okay, even though some claims have been made by various nations to this land, ice-covered land mostly, we will sign a treaty which allows sort of free investigation and free... movement around the continent, and let's study the area. And it's really been a very good thing, this treaty. And so it's a 30-year treaty signed in 59, so it goes until about 89. And so this has been a very good thing for Antarctic research.
But what would happen after 89?
Well, I think that it's like, you know, if nothing were found in the Antarctic, then the treaty would go along nicely. I mean, nothing found of value. I think that if indeed some metals were found which people would like to have, then there may be some difficulties in the future. But the cooperation between the various nations that are operating in the Antarctic is so good. I mean, for instance, this year we're having, the U.S. is going to be moving into one part of East Antarctica, some equipment that the French are going to use to drill a hole to study the ice. And at that same station, this in January, the end of January, the Soviets are going to be coming there on a traverse with an Australian navigator. So, you know, the cooperation is very good on this.
Well, this is fine, but we have to really look at this thing more carefully, because you have only 12 nations involved, and there are 144 nations in the world.
No, I think that's where the treaty
see,
is going to have
is,
some.
This is
you
the
know,
problem that has well, to be pointed out.
Well,
you know.
I realize that. Yeah. And I think that that's, you know, I think that's one of the considerations that these 12, I guess the 13 now, I think Poland acceded to the treaty this past year. And I think those countries are concerned as. Doing the best by the rest of the world in this area.
One of our viewers was interested in something that they read in the paper and wanted to know more about the possible use of icebergs to ameliorate the effect of hurricanes. That there was one of the papers that was given that said that there might very well be a possibility that this could be an effect.
No.
No.
No, because you don't know where the hurricane is. Suddenly it's there, yes, it takes a few days to develop, and your iceberg is 100 miles away. You can't move it fast enough to put
but
it into a
hurricane. But if by chance a hurricane occurred where the iceberg was, would you think that it would ameliorate
well,
the effect of the hurricane?
I can't believe it have anything to do with it.
No.
I don't think
it might take its roof off, but I
yeah, I was gonna say I don't think it'd be lifted out of the water. Oh, that would be very nice if it could be.
We are going to be back in just a moment. We do want to see the film that, or was it ENG coverage of the securing of the iceberg for Ames? And the first iceberg.
Yes, let's clarify, as much as I don't want to give any disrespect to the prince here, no matter how hard he tries, the first break he takes will be the second one that's been moved.
And for the very first iceberg for the first conference, you'll see it when we return after this message.
You're in Five Country, and we're WOI-TV from Ames, ABC for Central Iowa.
Because the iceberg that came to Ames has had such publicity, we thought that it would be interesting for you to see the, was it videotape?
It's a combination of videotape and 16
All
mixed
right.
together.
At any rate, it's the whole procedure of how it was secured and at least transported in its first stages. And so we're going to look at it very much like home movies. Anyone may comment and you will tell us about it and about your part in it, all right?
Sure. I always fall asleep with home movies.
Do you? Well, that's because we talk about, you know, so-and-so standing in front of such and such a monument. Well, in this case, it's the very first iceberg in all the world that's been transported to Ames, Iowa.
Thank you.
If you would go ahead and tell us about, you know, where you were and how you became involved. And we will look at the videotape.
The assignment was ice, and there it is. That is the Portage Glacier in the Chugach National Forest. It did not come from the Arctic Sea, like many people believe. That's just 60 miles south of Anchorage. It empties into a freshwater lake. You're probably looking at 120, 200 feet height there in the front. There's a shot looking down the lake. We're coming up on the glacier there now. It's about 2 miles long down that lake. And the process involved getting these divers in that boat and putting out there and selecting the proper piece of ice. And then getting the helicopters together and all the logistics involved of going out there and diving under the water, wrapping the net around it, hooking it up. And I don't know if the people can hear the sound on this.
Yes.
Yeah, they are.
Okay. There is, we understand, natural sound.
You should mention, I guess, that there were two helicopters, right?
Yeah, there was a support helicopter and then the actual big Huey helicopter that lifted it.
Was it difficult for you to select, since that is going to be one of the initial stages in the full-scale project?
We had a problem in that the wind had blown all the ice up against the face of the glacier, and that's a very dangerous place to operate, because chunks of ice can fall off at any moment. And we were approximately 60 feet away from that. We kind of went in a hurry and got out in a hurry. We towed the piece of ice away from the face so we wouldn't risk any hazard with the helicopter getting caught in that mess. But we had three pieces selected, and we started with the smallest one, which turns out to be actually bigger than what the helicopter could actually lift, but it finally did pull it out of the ground after 15 minutes of burning off enough fuel.
What's that on the lens there?
That's a little ice that we picked up. It was rather cold. The water was 32.8 degrees, and the wind picked up just as the helicopter here began to come in, and it made the maneuvering for it quite difficult.
This picture was taken from a helicopter.
Yeah, he was hovering about 5 or 10 feet above the ground, above the water.
You get seasick in the helicopter?
They did. They didn't feel so good when they got back to shore.
The person looking through the viewfinder is the one that has the tricky time, because that magnifies every movement.
There he is, just trying to feel the wind. The interesting thing about this lake is it's more of like a fjord. That is, there are steep cliffs coming up on either side. And when the wind picked up, it started moving the water. And the helicopter pilot, looking down at the water, felt he was moving forward, so he had no frame of reference. So we had to move the ice over next to the cliff, and it's just sheer walls. And so he would look at the cliff as well as look at the water, and the other helicopter pilot guided him down, as the people can hear here.
This is not colored ice, of course. It just looks that way.
Dr. Bader, what did you say?
That it was not colored ice.
Oh, colored ice.
It just is a distortion, partly through the window of the helicopter.
I see.
As a factor in transporting icebergs, including this one, the wind in this case is a problem for the helicopter. Will the wind itself be an asset in some instances for the moving of an iceberg itself?
It depends on which direction it comes from.
In some instances, I qualified it. Going your way, yes.
Yes.
There is a big surface, actually, that where the wind can come in, so there is a factor there for the wind.
If you have a good wind, you won't move at all.
Not a bit. Be nice if you could hit that kind when you reach your destination and want to stop at less than 22 miles.
Were there four people in wetsuits there swimming around the iceberg?
No, we had two divers and they were in dry suits. Dry suits filled with the air from the tanks. So they were quite comfortable. They actually had a fun time. The water was very murky. You couldn't see your hand in front of your face, but they had a lot of experience in that kind of water and they had no problem getting the net around it. It took them quite a while to get the net hooked up because the helicopter pilot was having a hard time. And he does have many hours, but finally he was able to snare it.
You mentioned that the water was murky, and we were talking about how pure the ice is. People are going to wonder about that. I think maybe it's we should explain that it's probably produced by what we call rock flour that's suspended in the water that you have there. The glacier moves down the valley, and there's an interaction between the ice and the rock, and so some rock is ground up, if you will, and that comes out around the edge of the glacier. That's why it would be murky in this case.
It was right about now when he realized he had a little bit more than he really wanted to play with.
You know, Ed, if you had told us before you came to Ames that there was this sack around the iceberg, we could have been prepared for creating it.
Yeah.
But we had no idea how to get it out of the box.
My assignment was get it to Ames.
No questions.
How did you finally take it? Did you cut the box off? Like take it off the side? Or?
No, it's quite an operation with a crane here and a forklift. And
I see.
Unexpected expense.
Yeah. Well, this is development of technology, really.
Oh, that's
right.
It's research.
But I think Iowa State did a good job in getting a piece of ice here. I mean, all in all.
I was just sorry to disappoint all the people who Kuhn group crowded together to see it taken out of the box. And when we looked inside, we realized we couldn't get it out of the box unless we had some huge equipment.
What were the final dimensions of the iceberg?
Well, that's hard to say because it changed continuously.
Actually, the final dimensions of that iceberg is zero, isn't it now?
Just about. I think there's a few slush piles left. I'm no longer attached to it, so it doesn't bother me. But until I got it here, I was really a little worried.
But the size when it actually arrived here? Well,
the actual weight of the ice that the helicopter lifted was 4,875 pounds, I believe. And 4,875. There it goes, finally.
Did people up in Alaska see this helicopter flying along? Did many people see this?
We had to fly it right along one of the major routes out of Anchorage, which is that it was a Friday afternoon we did it, and so everybody was leaving the city heading out to the country, and literally bumper to bumper traffic, and they, you know, you knew they were looking up at it. They'd known what the story was, and they finally had seen it flying by.
I see.
You mean you had the story out before you got the iceberg?
Oh yeah, there were a lot of people there watching.
Did they know it was coming to Ames, Iowa?
Oh yeah, you had excellent coverage up there.
You and the Alaskans know about us now, huh?
Well, it's closer than Saudi Arabia.
Yes, that's true.
This might start some sort of cooperative program between the Iowa State University and the University of Alaska.
Well, I would think a tripartite cooperation through Iowa.
Right.
It looks as though it's having really pretty heavy going.
He's probably just doing about 80 knots there. He couldn't do too much more. For some reason, he had a 50-gallon drum of fuel sitting in the plane full, so that made it a little more difficult. However, when we brought it to the parking lot at the edge of the lake, he let it down and we took that fuel barrel out, and it still had a hard time getting it up off the ground. It took another 5 minutes of burning off some fuel.
How many people were in the helicopter there?
There were three in there. One tender, one spotter, and then the pilot.
But he did have that rigged with a sort of a quick release in case he had any trouble, he could drop
it. Sure, it was right at his trigger finger. This was the more relieving part. Once you knew it could be flown without too much problem, the rest was just a matter of logistics at the airport and getting it into the box. Here we are, we're coming up now on the Portage Lake parking lot. It's a national forest, and people really get a bad view of the glaciers. It's so far down the lake, and this is probably the first piece of ice from it that people have actually been able to get up and touch. Sometimes it does wash up on the shore right there. And just as we arrived with the ice, there was this big tour bus that had pulled in there, and everybody was quite excited. They were all dressed in their mink coats and business suits. We decided we'd set it down there to check it and make sure that the net was not going to break on us over the highway.
Is that you in the blue coat?
That's yours truly.
I see. Okay.
Then you picked it up again.
Picked up again and just flew it the 60 miles back to Anchorage.
And thence to Ames.
Thence to Ames.
Several stops along the way and enjoying it today. The last time I saw it were little children and older people and professors and beauticians and
with
school
big buckets,
teachers and
with, big buckets,
with buckets, yes.
Chisels.
Yes. Well, and when I saw you, you were using a power saw trying to cut it, and it didn't look as though it had softened appreciably.
That was for research.
I see. Of course. But we call it always
research.
At any rate, it has been a most interesting thing and captured the imagination of many of the members of the press, certainly, and it's gone far and wide, and everyone knows that there has been an iceberg in Ames, Iowa.
I think we should give tribute to the people that thought up the idea, because it sure was the catalyst that launched the conference into the success that it is.
And there it is.
I did get a number of phone calls from environmentalists before the project went underway, thinking that it was a great error to remove ice from its natural habitat. And I had asked them, had they ever seen a glacier, and they said no. So I said, well, call me back when you know what they're like.
And it didn't bother you at all?
No, not when you live with it. It did bother me that they called at 2 o'clock in the morning, but that was beside the point.
Isn't that strange?
I once shipped almost as much ice as this back in 52. These were large crystals of ice which were used for research. This was packed in boxes and then taken to Seattle by ship. And then we had a refrigerated truck waiting for it. It was about 1.5 tons. And then we had to make sure we weren't going to lose it on the way. So at each state line, the state police from the other state took it over, and they always knew where the nearest ice house was in case the refrigerating unit on the truck would fail. And this was taken all the way to Chicago. And somehow the rumor got started. This was during the Korean War, that this was a transport of frozen Chinese from Korea.
Is iceberg ice colder than what we would call regular ice, ice house ice? Is it colder?
Well, no, I mean it is ice, yes. It is exactly the same, has the same crystal structure as the ice house ice. So how cold it is depends on where you put it.
Well, the ice coming off the Ross Ice Shelf, where the temperatures in the Antarctic are rather low, that ice is colder than the ice that you have in your ice box at home.
But it is not a matter of definition that says
no.
Iceberg ice is colder.
No.
One last question. How much loss will there be, do you anticipate, during the transport of the iceberg from Antarctica to Saudi Arabia? What figure do you use? Is it 30%, 50%?
Well, let's say we would try to shoot for 30%. It may be more, it may be less, depending on how it's handled, and we don't know.
We will be back with the final segment of Dimension 5, and each of our guests will have a chance to mention anything that they wanted to mention that they haven't mentioned so far. That will be after this message.
You're in 5 Country, and we're WOI-TV from Ames, ABC for Central Iowa.
Our subject tonight has been the first international conference on the utilization of icebergs. This is the last segment of our program, and most of these gentlemen aren't familiar with the ground rules, but when we started doing Dimension 5, we decided that it would be unwise for us to have anyone be able to leave the studio saying, I didn't have a chance to say what I wanted to say. So the last segment is yours, and I will ask each of you if there are any last statements that you would like to make, and I will begin with Dr. Bader. Any last comments, any last thoughts?
It was a very interesting conference, and it will at least lead to more research on icebergs, which has been somewhat neglected in the past. So it will help round out the picture we have in glaciology. It was a sort of, the iceberg is something you try to get out of the way of, and it was an obstacle to getting to the interior ice, which has been the object of research. Now we can start doing research on the iceberg, which is of great interest.
Thank you very much, and I do hope that you get to see one.
Yes, I hope so too.
In situ. Mr. Cronick.
I'm just glad to have provided my part in the picture. And if anyone in Ames wants more ice, just give me a call.
And the
ice price is right, I'll do it.
Dr. Zaffarano.
Well, I'd like to publicly acknowledge the wonderful support that our small committee has provided in organizing this conference. In particular, Paul Barkas, Bill Berkland, H.K. Baker, Zainab Sabri, and the most important person has been Abdo Husseini, who put together all the technical papers into some coherent form, did some selection, and it's really worked 24 hours a day for the last 2 months. They have made it possible to put on this conference in a short time. We started about the 1st of August, actually, really, to work out the details. And it's been a real pleasure working with these people.
And I'd like to thank Bill Berkland for helping to get you all here this evening, and I'm most grateful to him and to you. Dr. Cameron.
Oh, yes, I have a final comment. Earlier this evening, Dean Zaffarano turned to you and said, of course, you have, to you, young lady, that you had never, he just assumed you'd never built a model airplane. I'd like to ask you, did you ever build a model
yes,
airplane?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I
thank
did.
You. I thought you had, so all right.
May
now I
can,
thank
oh.
you.
Well, and I've flown in a hot air balloon, but I've not been on an iceberg.
Oh, you have, well, what about the balloon?
You may not know that Iowa is the hot air ballooning capital of the world at this mm-hmm. point, and that in August, at the end of August, we had 162 hot air balloonists competing in a little town called Indianola. And it's a very exciting sport, and
well, I know. I've been up a few times.
Do you like it?
Yes, I do.
Isn't that marvelous?
Very
that's now, very good. Yeah, okay. Back, yeah,
now we'll get back,
back
to
it. Yes.
I would like to, you know, as I'm with the National Science Foundation and have been a little bit involved in this program, I think that I would like to say that Iowa State University has done an excellent job in providing the base and the site for this meeting, and I wish to state that the driving force behind this this concept is Your Highness Prince Faisal, and I think he needs or he deserves a great deal of credit for encouraging this particular look at icebergs as a possible source of fresh water. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Prince Faisal?
Well, I think the last word is that, first of all, I'd like to thank the people who have participated in encouraging this conference, and also to thank the people who have participated in it, and also specially thank the university for being the host to all of us here and really doing a great job of organizing this conference. Of course, the individuals that are involved, Dr. Zaffarano has already mentioned them, and but if it wasn't for the forward-looking attitude of the university that has made it possible, I think they wouldn't have been able to do it. And I'd just like to say that I'm sure that everybody who has been here really, that Iowa now has a certain place in our hearts. And I think that looking into the future, Iowa would be, and Ames especially, would be a name that will probably be very close to the hearts of the Saudi Arabians, because that's where the whole thing started.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you especially for being here. And I will get the last word in just saying that perhaps if the iceberg age is upon us, we hope indeed that it will be a golden age. And we're awfully glad to have been part of the first conference, and we can tell our grandchildren about it when many of the problems of the world perhaps have been solved because of it. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for your questions. Join us next week. We are going to be talking about biomedical ethics. We'll see you then. Good night.